There are several prophecies that our Elohim gave to his servants, the prophets that pertain to him raining down stones from heaven upon the inhabitants of this earth at the time of the end. He commanded us to purge out that which opposes his righteousness from our midst. And in several places, he told us to do so through stoning them. He chose such a horrific vehicle as stoning to show us the exceeding wickedness of transgressing against that which is right before his eyes. And he did so in order that those whom he was calling to become his eternal children would fear the punishment for transgressing against him. Therefore, they would choose to not sin. They would realize that transgressing against him is serious business before his eyes. It is serious business because it cuts us off from eternal life in his family. Unrepented sin leads to eternal death, and sin is transgressing against him. Repentance is turning from your transgressing against him. Instead of fearing to transgress against him, nearly all of those whom he was calling to become his chose to get rid of the punishment for transgressing against him. And because of this, sin has prevailed in our midst. We have reached the point in time now that his temple is finished, that he is going to purge out those of you who desire to continue in your transgressing against him. And he is going to do so through a time of great trouble that will include stoning many of you with stones from heaven, along with artillery shells from those whom he is rising up to come against you. In a recent video called the Yom Kippur War, I read a prophecy that is recorded in Ezra chapter 10, verse 9. In 3 days, all of the men of Judah and Benjamin, referring to the remnant that were there, gathered themselves together to Jerusalem, and it was the ninth month, on the 20th day of the month, and all of the people sat in the street of Elohim's house, trembling upon the word of rain. The final 40 days of Yahweh's 430-day prophecy that he gave through his servant Ezekiel for the end time Son of Man testifies that Yahweh has gathered Benjamin and Judah into the west at this time. The 20th day of the ninth month on Yahweh's restored calendar will be on December 3rd this year on Satan's calendar. The first day of the 40-day prophecy of the 430-day prophecy begins on December 4th. 3 days prior to the 20th day of the ninth month is November 30th. On November 30th, we will be 51 days out from the end of the great and fearful day of his wrath. Per a similitude of his Elijah prophecy, where Elijah went with the third group of 51 men to tell Ahaziah face-to-face that he was going to die, at some point during these 51 days, Yahweh is going to rise me up before your face. He's going to rise me up before your face to tell you that you will surely die if you do not turn from your rebellion to him and to that which he has restored. This Ezra prophecy is saying that he has aimed his rain of hailstones at the west. This does not mean that the rest of the world and the rest of the scattered descendants of Israel are not going to receive them, because they will. It is just that this prophecy is a particular prophecy to include Judah and Benjamin. There are plenty of other prophecies that include the rest of Israel. Plus, there are also other tribes of Israel that are represented in the United States besides Judah and Benjamin. Along with others, much of Ephraim and Manasseh are gathered here. The reason why the remnant of the children of Judah and Benjamin were gathering in 3 days back then, it is because they were gathering together to make a covenant with the Most High to turn from the rebellion to him and to return to walking with him in his statutes and his judgments. Ezra was told of the abominations that were done in their midst, and he was utterly broken. The prophecy says that they were given word of rain, and they responded to it. They gathered together in just 3 days to make a covenant with the Most High to turn from their whoredoms to him. Will you gather together in order to become the remnant that will be delivered through the coming time of affliction? Or will you forbear and scoff and mock and maybe even be of those who end up blaspheming the Most High when this rain is sent upon you? This prophecy singles out that one of their transgressions that they transgressed against the Most High was they took wives from the filthy heathen nations that were around about them. This prophecy ties in their doing so with playing the whore to the Most High. Ezra the priest gathered them together to make a covenant with Yahweh to separate themselves from the people of the land and to put away their strange wives. They were agreeing to put away their whoredoms to Yahweh. For some of you, this will mean physically leaving your spouses or your children who refuse to turn from their whoredoms to him. I can assure you that it is not a coincidence that Ezra and the elders singled out this particular transgression in this prophecy. In lieu of his command for you to flee at this time, It is very significant that Ezra was also telling them to separate themselves from the people of the land. Ezra said that whoever refused to come to Jerusalem in 3 days were to be separated from the congregation. Verse 13 says that the rain that came was so bad that the people were not able to stand outside. Here is what the revelations of our Messiah that were given to the Apostle John say in Revelation chapter 6. And the stars of heaven fell into the earth in the manner that a fig tree cast off her unripened figs when she is shaken by a mighty wind. His reference to the fig tree and the unripened figs being cast off is a reference to those of you who were not part of his first fruit harvest. It is a reference to those of you who refused to turn to that which will circumcise your hearts like those who became his first fruits did. And then in verse 14, we are told, and the heavens separated in the manner that a scroll is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich and the chief captains and the mighty and every bondman and free man hid themselves in caves and in the rocks of the mountains and said to the mountains and to the rocks, fall upon us and hide us from the face of him that sits upon the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, because the great day of his wrath is come, and who will be able to stand? In case you have a short memory, in Kipwe's prophecy that he gave during the days of Ezra, they were not able to stand outside because of the rain. The reality is, in the days ahead, only those of you who separate yourselves from those of the world, who do not want that which is right before our Creator's eyes, and turn from your whoredoms to the Most High, will be left standing. In Hosea chapter 10, we read, your vain high places and the sin of Israel will be destroyed. The thorn and the thistle will come up upon your altars, and you will say to the mountains and to the hills, fall upon us and cover us. O Israel, you have sinned since the days of Gibeah, where the children of iniquity stood upon the battle of Gibeah, and you did not overtake them. This is an incredibly dynamic prophecy. Kipwe gave 3 end-time prophecies against Gibeah. He gave all 3 of them through his servant Hosea. When the children of Israel cried out for a king, Kipwe raised them up the type of king that their rebellious, disbelieving hearts desired. He rose up Saul to be king over them in order to illustrate to them and to us the type of king that most of their and your hearts desire. Therefore, King Saul represented the people's choice for a king. They did not desire for Kipwe to be king over them. The witness against you that the Most High has sent me with proves that neither do you. He then rose up David to illustrate to us the type of man that was after his heart. Saul was of the tribe of Benjamin, and he was from Gibeah. Kipwe's word refers to Gibeah as the house of Saul. Saul of Tarsus was also from the tribe of Benjamin. Nearly all of you have chosen to follow after Saul's word instead of following after Kipwe's only begotten son and his word. The battle of Gibeah is symbolic of the test that Kipwe set up in raising up Saul of Tarsus to represent an opposing pathway. Kipwe's word that explains that he created both good and evil, he did so in order to give us the choice. Evil is everything that opposes that which is right before his eyes. Saul of Tarsus represented the people's choice. He brought to you that which your rebellious, uncircumcised ears and hearts wanted to hear. Along with David and the rest of the patriarchs, our Messiah represented and still represents Yahweh's choice. Yahweh manifested his only begotten Son to us in the flesh as his word in the flesh. Yeshua was and is one with his Father. And he told us that we must become one with them if we are going to have eternal life in Kipwe's family awarded to us. But you loved Saul's more excellent way instead. This is because you do not love our Creator's righteousness. In the verse following Kipwe's 30-day prophecy that he gave to us through his servant Hosea, he tells us in chapter 5, verse 8, blow the shofar in Gibeah, referring to the house of Saul, and the trumpet in Ramah, their high places, and shout at Bethhaven, the house of vanity, after you, O Benjamin, for those who follow after you, O Saul of Tarsus. So this verse is saying, blow the shofar in the house of Saul, and the trumpet in their high places, and shout at the house of vanity, for those of you who follow after you, O Saul of Tarsus. In the preceding verse, Yahweh tells us, in a month he is going to devour you because you have begat children that are strangers to him. This video started off with the prophecy for Israel to put away your strange wives and to return to the Most High by separating yourselves from the heathens who choose to hold fast to their vain images of him. In the days of Elijah, it did not rain for 3 years. Yahweh's prophecy for his 2 witnesses tells us that they were given the authority to shut up the rain. Early in September, in a video called A Small Cloud Like a Man's Hand, Gateway began revealing that the rain that he is referring to, that he has held back during these first 3 years, is the abundance of war. Today, he is telling you that this rain is also the stones that are soon going to come raining down upon you from the heavens. In the Yom Kippur video, I posed two questions concerning Ezra 10:9. Is the rain that this verse is referring to the rain of hailstones from heaven that might be coming in the tail of the comet Isan? Is it the rain of artillery shells that will be coming upon you from those whom Yahweh has empowered to come against you? The answer to this is this rain will be both stones from heaven and artillery shells. Whether the rain is from heaven is from Isan or from a collection of comets is not the point. The point is this rain is coming. I'll share with you some verses that testify that the rain is referring to both. In Isaiah 30, verse 30, Yahweh will cause his glorious voice to be heard, and you will see the lightning of his arm and the indignation of his wrath and the flame of a devouring fire and a dashing into pieces and an overflowing hail of stones, because Yahweh will break you down with his voice and he will smite you with the rod of the Assyrian. This verse is saying that the hail of stones will come from the enemy that he sends upon you. Earlier in verse 13 of this prophecy, he tells us that this will be because of the breach that you have earnestly desired. He tells us what this breach is. In verse 13, therefore this iniquity that you earnestly desire is a breach, and it will be to you as a high wall that has fallen, that in an instant will suddenly come crashing down. The breach between you and the Most High is the iniquity or the violating of his Torah that you earnestly desire. In Ezekiel 13, verse 11, say to them which daub the wall with untempered mortar, it will fall, and there will be a gushing rain of great hail of stones, and it and you who remain in it will fall. The storms and the winds will break it down. Lo, when your wall has fallen, will it not be said to you, where is the dubbing which you have dubbed it with? Therefore, thus saith Adonai Yahweh, I will break down your wall. He is going to break down all of the false religions that are set up with lies by the false prophets and the false shepherds, with storms and winds in my fury, and there will be a gushing rain of a great hail of stones to destroy it in my anger and in my fury. Here the hail is speaking about stones that will accompany the storm of his fury. How big will some of these stones be? When the seventh angel pours out the seventh vial that was given to him, we are told in Revelation 16:21, and there fell upon men a great hail out from heaven as the weight of a talent, and men blasphemed Elohim out from the plague of the hail, because the plague thereof was exceeding great. This hail will be sent towards the end of the great and the fearful day of Yahweh's wrath. However, the revelations of our Messiah also speak about hail that will be mixed with blood that will accompany that which will result from the first angel sounding the trumpet that he has been sounding. We have come to the end of the time that the Most High has been crying out for you through a small voice to flee to the hills and the mountains for the second Exodus. Yahweh has been crying out for you to return to him through that which he has restored for these past 3+ years now. He is getting ready to magnify this small, quiet voice. He also sent great hail at the time of the first Exodus. He said that when he did, fire ran along the ground. At that time, it was a time of hail that the world had not ever seen before. But it was nothing compared to that which he is going to send at this time. In Psalms 18, David prophesied of a hail that will soon be, of the hail that will soon be cast upon you as being like coals of fire. In chapter 23, Ezekiel prophesied that those whom the Most High is going to send upon you are going to stone you with stones. Micah prophesied that Yahweh is going to rain down stones on Samaria. Samaria is where the 10 tribes of Israel were before they were further scattered. In the preceding verse, Yahweh included that the wound of this prophecy will also come upon Judah. In Micah 1:5, all of the rebellion of Jacob and the sins of the house of Israel are this. What is the rebellion of Jacob? Is it not Samaria? Is it not the captivity? And what are the high places of Judah? Are they not Jerusalem? He is saying that because of our ancestors' rebellion to him and because of their high places, he sent them and us into the captivity and scattered us abroad. His word has testified that Jerusalem is referring to the west at this time, where Judah and Benjamin are also gathered. But this is beside the point. Yahweh's point is he is going to stone you with stones from heaven and with artillery shells from those whom he is rising up against you. His word tells us to stone the adulterer in order to burn adultery from our midst. He is going to stone stone you because of your adultery to him if you do not turn from it. And a great and terrible stoning it is going to be. This time of great affliction will cause a remnant of you to come down out from your high places in order to become the planting in the millennium where you can live to become part of the latter harvest into his family. He is telling you, my people, come out from the mystery Babylon so that you are not partakers of her sins and so that you do not receive of her calamity. Thus saith Yahweh Elohim.